This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. Affirmative action died last week. Dean Matt Spalding of Hillsdale College and the Board of Directors of New College in Florida. So he serves in management positions at both a private and a public university. Joins me to talk about what does the Harvard and UNC case mean for every college and university in the United States. Stay tuned.
You won't want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel. This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. Affirmative action died last week. Dean Matt Spalding of Hillsdale College and the Board of Directors of New College in Florida. So he serves in management positions at both a private and a public university. Joins me to talk about what does the Harvard and UNC case mean for every college and university in the United States. Stay tuned.
You won't want to miss a minute.
a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. We're nothing perfect or considered, but we're so damn good. It's the story of your life.
Morning, glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt live from Studio North this morning. I'm so glad you are with me. My screen is frozen. I hope yours isn't, because I'm going to play for you some critical excerpts from a documentary I watched. It's not a documentary. I don't know what to call this. Let me begin at the beginning. There is some news. It's not much. And markets are horrible. The jobs report was very strong. Inflation hasn't gone away. And we don't know who did the cocaine in the West Wing. There, that's everything that broke overnight. And it's a kind of a weird news week anyway, because July 4th comes on a Tuesday, which basically means the entire news week is broken. But yesterday, John Ellis of Ellis Items and News Items on Substack and Political News Items on Substack, and I believe if you're going to subscribe to one thing in the world, subscribe to News Items from John Ellis, because he's really widely respected by both left, right, and center, and it does a fine job of summarizing all the news. Well, yesterday afternoon, John Ellis sent out a very rare, for him, alert. Is there one piece, he wrote, that captures the risks of runaway artificial intelligence, AI? There are, of course, many such pieces. They're all over the internet. But if you have an hour to spare, I recommend you watch this presentation by Tristan Harris and Asa Raskin at the Aspen Ideas Festival. It's well worth your time. Now, they are with the Center for Humane Technology, and you should know that the center was originally funded and may still be funded by George Soros and others. So I have some suspicions coming in. Pierre Omidyar as well was a funder of the Center for Humane Technology. But I trust Ellis. I mean, I really trust Ellis. And if he says watch something, and he doesn't do it very often, I watched it. And let me give you a couple of clips about it. And I think you should watch it. If you want a good idea of what could go wrong with artificial intelligence, then you want to do so. You want to talk. You want to listen to them talk about the future with AI. Cut number 12 is one excerpt from it.
Could you imagine how different we would be walking into this next age? We walked into the nuclear age, but at least we woke up and we created the UN Bretton Woods. We're walking into the AI age, but we're not waking up and creating institutions that span countries. Imagine how different it would be if there was a nationalized, televised, not debate, but discussion from the heads of the major labs and companies and the lead safety experts like the Eliezers. And civic actors. And we really gave this moment in history the weight that it deserves versus another sort of weird article in the New York Times about how the chatbot tried to break up the reporter from their wife.
Yeah. Part of why we did this is that we noticed that the media has not been covering this in a way that lets you see kind of the picture of the arms race. It's actually been one of our focuses is getting and helping media who help the world understand these issues, not see them as chatbots or see it as just AI art, but seeing it as there's a systemic challenge where we're racing, that corporations are currently caught, not because they want to be, because they're caught in this arms race to deploy it and to get market dominance as fast as possible. And none of them can stop it on their own. It has to be some kind of negotiated agreement where we all collectively say, which future do we want? Just like nuclear de-escalation. And what we have heard when we ask
for a moment,
all the time,
there are many, many premises that these young men, and they are relatively young men, do not understand about the nuclear age, how it was born, how it was not regulated, how Atoms for Peace did not work, how proliferation regimes did not hold, And so much of the analogies that they deploy throughout the AI dilemma are deeply flawed. I'm telling you all the bad stuff at the beginning before I tell you the good stuff. The worst 3 minutes of the hour and 10-minute presentation are these, cut number 11.
But there are also other moments where humanity faced an existential challenge and looked face-to-face in the mirror. How many people here are aware of the film The Day After? Okay, about half of you. It was the largest watched made-for-TV film in all of human history. It was about the prospect of nuclear war, which again was a kind of abstract thing that people didn't really want to think about, and let's repress it and not talk about it, and it's really hard. But they basically said, we need to get the United States and Russia and its citizen populations to see what would happen in that situation. And they aired it was the largest made-for-TV film. 100 million Americans saw it. 3 or 4 years later, in 1987, they aired it to all Russians. And it helped lead to a shared understanding of the fate that we move into if we go to full-scale nuclear war. And what I wanted to show you was a video that after they aired this to 100 million Americans, they actually followed it with an hour and a half Q&A discussion and debate between some very special people. So imagine you just saw a film about nuclear war. I think this will feel good to watch this.
There is, and you probably need it about now, there is some good news. If you can, take a quick look out the window. It's all still there. Your neighborhood is still there, so is Kansas City and Lawrence and Chicago and Moscow and San Diego and Vladivostok. What we have all just seen, and this was my third viewing of the movie, what we've seen is sort of a nuclear version of Charles Dickens' Christmas Carol. Remember Scrooge's nightmare journey into the future with the spirit of Christmas yet to come? When they finally return to the relative comfort of Scrooge's bedroom, the old man asks the spirit the very question that many of us may be asking ourselves right now. Whether, in other words, the vision that we've just seen is the future as it will be, or only as it may be. Is there still time? To discuss, and I do mean discuss, not debate, that and related questions tonight, we are joined here in Washington by a live audience and a distinguished panel of guests. Former Secretary of State, Henry Kissinger. Elie Wiesel, philosopher, theologian, and author on the subject of the Holocaust. William F. Buckley, Jr., publisher of the National Review, author, and columnist. Carl Sagan, astronomer and author who most recently played a leading role in a major scientific study on the effects of nuclear war.
So you see that they put the day after as a centerpiece of their discussion of the nuclear regime. That's not true. It had a million people watch it. They said the film led Ronald Reagan into a depression. That's not true. They said that Reykjavik worked, the summit between Gorbachev and Reagan, and it was prompted by the day after. That's just 100% wrong. Reykjavik was a 1986 summit on, of course, Iceland between Reagan and Gorbachev, wherein Gorbachev attempted to persuade Reagan to abandon nuclear weapons, and Reagan walked out. And everyone was quite down in the mouth, even, you know, the Prince of Darkness, Richard Perle. I was in the administration at that time, so I followed it very, very closely. Not in the White House anymore. I'd left the White House the year before and gone over to Office of Personnel Management. But I will tell you, they don't know anything about nuclear nonproliferation, about the arms race, about the day after. They constructed a myth about the past to frame their concerns about the future. That does not, and I want to emphasize that, undermine their concerns about the future. Those concerns are very, very real. And the artificial intelligence dilemma, the AI dilemma, if you go over to hughhewitt.com, or I mean to Twitter, to my account, at Hugh Hewitt, I have linked it, and it takes 70 minutes to watch it. And when we come back, I may just play the beginning of it from the moment that they're introduced. They are very, very persuasive. Right? These young men, and they are young men, Tristan Harris and Asa Raskin, are with the Center for Humane Technology. And the Center for Humane Technology, the first slide you read about it is, because I believe this 70-minute documentary is going to be profoundly influential, this presentation. Their website begins, our journey began in 2013 when Tristan Harris, then a Google design ethicist, created the viral presentation, a call to minimize distraction and respect user attention. That presentation, followed by two TED Talks and a 60-minute interviews, sparked the Time Well Spent movement and laid the groundwork for the founding of the Center for Human Technology as an independent 501c3 in 2018. While many people are familiar with our work through The Social Dilemma, which you may have seen on a streaming platform, our focus goes well beyond the negative effects of social media. We work to expose the drivers behind all extractive technology steering our thoughts, behaviors, and actions. We believe that by understanding the root causes of a harmful technology, we can work together to build a more humane future. My questions at the break, Will, how can anyone judge a 70-minute presentation at the very left-wing Aspen Institute Ideas Festival without knowing more? And I'll explain more afterward, but I do want you to go and watch The AI Dilemma. I've linked it over at my Twitter account. Stay tuned. Good Friday, America. It's Hugh Hewitt on July 7, 7723. I'm talking about a presentation made at the Aspen Institute Aspen Ideas Festival. A few disclosures. The Aspen Institute is very left-wing. It was used to be centrist, now it's very left-wing. The Aspen Ideas Festival is very left-wing. The presenters that I'm focusing on, Asa Raskin and Tristan Harris, are very left-wing. Both of them are 39 and 40 or 40 and 39, respectively. Tristan went to Stanford and got a BS, and Asa went to University of Chicago and got a BS. That's it. They are not lawyers. They have no advanced degrees. They are successful techies who lived the Silicon Valley life and now want to guide you into artificial intelligence and its dangers. They reflect the progressive ideology that expertise ought to make all policy and that civic society leaderships, which is a shorthand way of saying us and our buddies in Silicon Valley and the people who fund us and George Soros and the left, all ought to run everything, trust us. And I don't. And I want you to know, I still, though, think you ought to watch the AI dilemma, because what they do very well is tell you where we are with artificial intelligence and why it is such a threat. It's a nuclear warhead level threat because its power is exponentially growing at an exponential rate. So 2 becomes 4, 4 becomes 16, 16 becomes whatever that is, 164. It's not growing, you know, at a 2x or a 3x. They say 10 times, but it means exponential growth. And soon AI, if it's not already, will teach itself how to get better. So if you ever saw War Games, it's that scenario, but it's actually happening. And the only answer that occurs to me based on history is that the United States have a national security branch, and we probably do at DARPA, that can out AI anyone. And if anybody attacks us with AI, for example, if the Chinese Communist Party directs its artificial intelligence operators to hack everything in the United States and bring it all down, we have a standalone capacity to do the same thing to them. I don't know how they would get to, and we have got to defend, for example, our nuclear submarine, the Ohio class and the forthcoming Columbia class, and our ultimate deterrent, the nuclear deterrent, against AI. But AI is actually more perverse and subtle than nuclear weaponry. And they do a fine job of alarming you. Their solutions are cracked because they don't know any history, and the history that they think they know is wrong. All right, so that's a very dangerous combination, to be very, very smart about some things and to be wrong about other. There's only one Silicon Valley guy who I really trust to think about politics, and that is Peter Thiel. And I know Peter, and he's been a guest on this program. I have had dinner with Mark Zuckerberg. Mark Zuckerberg has been my guest at the Nixon Foundation. Not sure I trust Mark on AI. I don't think they're lefties or conspiracy there. I just don't think they know much. Thiel does. Thiel evinces a great deal of reading beyond tech. Mark, not so much. Elon Musk, who I do not know and have only heard once in person, does not evince a lot of history. And I have a piece coming out in the Washington Post on Sunday about, look, I don't even want to talk to you if you don't know history, because human beings are human beings are human beings. Now, AI is a new machine. And like the dawn of the nuclear age, it's a very deadly new machine. And people have to think about it, know about it, and consider it, but not in an alarmist sort of way, and not in order to draw attention and attraction to themselves. And by the way, I don't want any summits at the White House. I want long conversations between very smart people about AI that are done in public, and that the technologists will explain to the lawyers, and the lawyers will explain to the judges, and the judges and the lawyers will explain to the regulators, and everyone will explain to the legislators and the executive branch what it means and why it matters, and that we have a branch of the Department of Defense working round the clock on artificial intelligence and deterring the use of it against Americans and their freedom. That's the important part. But you'll learn so much from this documentary, the AI, this presentation, the AI dilemma, that you have never known before. For example, do you realize that in 3 seconds of my voice, advanced AI that exists now can actually create Hugh Hewitt saying anything? So the deep fake era is definitely upon us. That's just the thing that stuck with me. There are millions of hours. I've been on the air since 1990. So you take 33 years of me saying anything and you're going to be able to piece that together. But not just me, you. Adam and Harley and Ben are all been on the air at least 3 seconds, so they can be generated into entire personalities by the creative process of artificial intelligence, and AI can teach itself. So this is a very interesting and indeed alarming moment. I am not sure of the solution. I know I am reading everything I can about it. I've written once about it for the Washington Post. I will write again. But I want you to go and watch that. I'm going to talk with Sonny Bunch about it after the break a little bit, because I think it's going to destroy the movie business too, in the way that it's destroying music videos and the people who make them. It's going to destroy everything that requires language, large language model skills, and replace it with something new. And if you want a warning, go watch over at my Twitter account. I've linked the AI dilemma from the Aspen Institute, and then come back for Sonny Bunch on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of The Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by the Council for Citizens Against Government Waste.
Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt on a Friday, 7/7/23. Sonny Bunch joins me, the official movie critic of the Hugh Hewitt Show. Good morning, Sonny. How are you?
I'm great, Hugh. How are you?
Great. Did you watch on one of the streaming platforms The Social Dilemma when it came out?
No.
Okay. The Social Dilemma was a huge movie about social media and its impacts on people. And it was a documentary. It made quite an impact. It came from the Center for Humane Technology and a couple of guys named Tristan Harris and Aza. And are you familiar with anything they've done?
No. Okay. No
they
idea
are,
who these people are.
They are futurists out of Silicon Valley, 39 and 40 years old, respectively, your generation, who've been funded by a lot of people about whom I'm normally not so enthusiastic. But John Ellis recommended I watch their presentation at the Aspen Ideas Institute, which is called The AI Dilemma. And it talks about how we are at the very beginning of what will be a huge revolution, a very dangerous moment in science. And it occurs to me that theater critics, movie critics, film people like you have been dealing with AI for a long time, sort of in CGI and the rapidly evolving techniques of making movies. And am I right that movies have changed dramatically in their making over the last 25 years?
Sure. Yeah, I think that's fair to say.
And how much of an impact has CGI had on it?
Well, I mean, enormous. So there are two different ways to think about how CGI has affected the way movies are made, right? The first is the kind of death of on location in real life shooting, right? So you have you now have entire franchises that are essentially shot in warehouses in Atlanta. That's, you know, all the Marvel stuff.
By the way, CGI, for the benefit of the Steelers fans, means computer-generated, what does it mean, computer-generated?
Images.
Images, yeah. So there's a lot of fake stuff in movies.
Yeah, so I mean, it's not just about, you know, making you believe a man could fly, right? It's not just the promise of 1978 Superman brought to its fullest extent. I mean, it's beyond that. It's changing how you actually shoot a movie and how you do that. The technology on that end has gotten in some ways much better, and much cheaper. The whole promise of the Star Wars shows, for instance, on Disney Plus has been that they can shoot them in this thing called the Volume, which is a big LED room, basically, that they can shoot real-time CGI stuff in, so the director can see it happening instantly, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, the long and the short of it, though, is that it has contributed to a real lack of reality and a real lack of connection with anything in the real world, which certainly has consequences for the look and the feel of a thing, but also, again, just, you know, leads to some breakdowns in basic cinema techniques on the ends of cinematographers, that sort of thing. If you want to know why everything looks fake, it's not because they're using CGI. It's because a lot of people just have no idea how to shoot things nowadays.
Now, CGI began to appear about when?
I mean, you could go back to Tron, right? Tron was a very early instance of computer-generated graphics impacting how things looked on screen. I mean, you could probably even go a little further back than that, but that was the big mainstream one. That was
okay.
Big.
Tron is 40 years ago. That's 1982. Yep. So for 40 years, we've been watching cinema move, and Sonny's been practicing his craft for what, 20 years?
Yeah, about that. Yeah.
All right. So you've been watching this acceleration. And what the AI dilemma proposes, and I don't know that it persuades, but it proposes, is that exponential rate of change in the technology is going to impact everything, so that AI-generated large language models, what they call golems, because golem is a scary thing, if you're familiar with the golem in Jewish Talmudic teaching. And the golems out there, these large language models, and they've got another term for the acronym, are going to take over everything. And they're going to put everyone out of business, and they're going to change the way we do everything. And they are certainly going to change movies, because the CGI is kind of like, if we're talking about the big bang of technology, CGI was at the beginning of it. We are going to exponentially expand the universe of it now. Does that worry you, Sonny Bunch?
Yes, to a certain extent. I mean, look, this is one of the reasons the writer strike that's going on right now is actually pretty important for reasons beyond, you know, just getting the writers extra money. One of the things that they are demanding is essentially a halt to the use of AI in script development, script generation, et cetera. They want a complete kibosh on that on the studio end, and the studio countered with, we'll have a meeting with you every 6 months to discuss how we're using AI in script generation. And obviously the writers were like, well, in 6 months, as you say, in 6 months, 6 months is the equivalent of, you know, 10 years in this sped up world of, you know, how things are developing.
Yeah, you know, I believe it's an extinction level event for screenwriters. And it's an extinction level event for a lot of people in the movie industry, like it is an extinction level event for columnists, newspapers, and the delivery of news. And I don't know that anyone is got their arms around it. All these two young men from Silicon Valley have their take on it. I don't know if I can trust them, because they think the day after actually sent Ronald Reagan into a depression, and that Reykjavik was about nuclear nonproliferation, when in fact it was a failed summit where Gorbachev attempted to destroy SDI. What do you think about people who get fundamental things wrong about history as they're explaining the future, Sonny?
Well, this is the Hugh Hewitt test, right? This is why you got to know your facts when you're running for things like what is the nuclear triad and all that stuff. I mean, look, it's a real problem, and the futurists have always been nervous about AI. I mean, I could either nervous about or almost longing with religious fervor. There are two real camps here, right? There are the people who believe that AI is going to destroy everything, like the guys you're talking about right now. But then you have the Ray Kurzweil types. You know who Ray Kurzweil is?
Science fiction writer?
Well, so he's another futurist who back in, I want to say, the late 90s or early 2000s wrote a book called The Age of Spiritual Machines, which is essentially an argument that starting pretty soon here in the next, you know, 20 years or so, we will develop the technology to we will develop two things kind of in tandem. One is an exponentially improving AI, the sort of AGI that will surpass us in our ability to think and reason and all that in very short order here. But then also that we will develop the technology to functionally upload our brains to the cloud, to put not too fine a point on it, which would give humans a sort of immortality. It's fundamentally a religious proposition, I think, that second part. The first part is more rooted in reality, and I think is a thing worth thinking and worrying about. I'm a little less sure than you are that AI scripts would be a extinction-level event, because I do think that those still have kind of a long way to go before they improve. And I don't think it works for columnists either, Hugh, because I mean the whole point of a good columnist is you like the personality of the writer. It's not necessarily just having content and arguments there to share and click and all that stuff. You develop relationships with writers and
The one thing I take away from it, Sonny, and I hope you will watch the AI revolution or the AI dilemma and review it at some point, is that they demonstrated that if you have 3 seconds of someone's voice, you can generate their voice saying anything for great periods of time, which is a very alarming deal, right, for the deepfake world.
Well, this is a secondary question here, right, which is that I do think we are nearing a real moment where the ability to generate any image, any video, any audio clip that you want of a public figure is here. I mean, I think that's a much bigger problem than anything else we've discussed right now, because I think we have reached the point where you cannot believe your own eyes anymore. You cannot believe your own ears anymore. And that's going to have real, real knock-on effects for
the anyone could take short. Sonny Bunch, the voice, the amount of voice you put on your two podcasts across the movie aisle and The Bulwark Goes to the Movies, or your conversations with me, and they could generate a Sonny Bunch review of any movie.
You know, it's funny though, because I've had friends try to do that with my reviews, and look, I've got 20 years of written criticism out there too, right? And they go to the ChatGPT and they're like, write a review of XYZ in the style of Sonny Bunch, and it just sounds nothing like me. I mean, it just sounds nothing like my written words. So I feel like we're still kind of a ways off.
Well, the ways to go, their analogy, I think, in the AI dilemma is we had a ways to go when we were building railroads, and now we're doing hypersonic missiles. And that took 100 years. This is going to take 1 year, 2 years. That's their proposition, Sonny. Do you believe it out of the box?
Right. I mean, it's exponential growth, and exponential growth is a very scary thing when you're dealing with supercomputers. So it's possible. It's certainly possible.
The best movies on this are War Games and The Matrix. Any other ones come to mind about where technology takes over? The Rise of the Machines, too.
Yeah, I mean, you could look at the Terminator movies, right? Those are. I don't know. I would have to think about that one.
All right, Sonny Bunch. Homework week, because there's nothing new at the movies anyway. Follow him at Sonny Bunch. Listen to his two podcasts, including Across the Movie Aisle and The Bulwark Goes to the Movies. And I hope he watches The AI Dilemma. I'll be right back, America. Tarzana Joe is next. Joined now by the poet laureate of the Hugh Hewitt Show, Tarzana Joe. Good morning, Joe. Do you have one shirt?
No, this is a variety of shirts. This is a closet full of shirts. I don't wear them all at the same time, just once every week.
Wait, who's asking the question about if you have one shirt?
Well, I have many blue shirts, but that's a pattern Hawaiian shirt, and Joe wears it every week.
Maybe it's a Joe-a-form.
Not true. Not true. I shall make it clearer next week when I wear a brighter red and white Hawaiian shirt. I could go get one now if you'd like, but I think I'd rather stay
could
here.
Could be a Guardian shirt. Guardians are red, white, and blue. Just telling you. Just saying. Don't you wear a Yankee shirt on this show.
Never. I watched the Guardians game for a few minutes yesterday. It was a lot of fun.
Ooh, no. All right, the poem, Joe, the poem.
All right. I have found in my experience the view is sometimes clearer when crises or disasters are seen through the rearview mirror. The problem with adherence to the sentence I just said is that all through our existence we've been told to look ahead, focus on the future. We don't need no introspection. Think about the next disease, the next debate, the next election. There's a due date I've been dreading. There's a meeting that I'm late for. The phone rings and we can't perceive the cliff we're heading straight for. Now, I'm not the first, you argue, and I sure won't be the last that this view sees us repeating the disasters from the past. If I surveyed every one of you, or even only 10 of you, you'd say that humanity has been doing this for perhaps the last millennia. But today the stakes are higher as we spin on the ecliptic, and minute miscalculations can become apocalyptic. So before you spend a dollar on a candidate or vote, take some time to think about what Santayana wrote. Between a brighter future and the one that we've all dreaded, we need to think what we've been through to get to where we're headed. And that's Yes, Virginia, There Is a Santayana by Tarzana Joe.
You know, Santayana gets a workover, and Herman Woke did not much care for George Santayana. He said you could smell the anti-Semitism in the room when he walked in.
Is he remembered for that or for the one phrase that he has that handed one. Down?
Now, I got a question for you. What's in the rearview mirror when you drive over the cliff? Blue skies.
We'll go out with that tune if there was a producer, Mr. Blue Sky.
Not going to happen.
I actually thought the quote was by Montaigne, and I was going to call the poem "Ain't No Montaigne High Enough." So that goes.
You know,
with the
other day I just converted from saying Montaigne after 30 years to saying Montaigne, and then I heard someone pronounce it Montaigne. Did you take French?
I took it and I gave it back. Yes.
Okay, you and me both. I don't know, and I give up because no matter what you do, you're wrong. It's like working with Dwayne. Joe, I hope business is brisk at TarzanaJoe@Reagan.com, where all your poetry needs are met exceptionally quickly and for a fair price.
Absolutely. You gave me a very busy July 4th weekend with your comments last week, but this week
did they come in?
Push the books. The second best of Tarzana Joe, and it only hurts when I rhyme, right back there on the wall. Available on Amazon, and I've written them a long time ago, so I don't have to work so hard when someone buys the books.
When is Volume 3 coming out?
When my wife nudges me hard enough. She's been
TarzanaJoe.com also has a link to the Amazon page, correct?
Indeed, it does.
But if you want to rhyme, you've got to write to him at his email, TarzanaJoe@Reagan.com. Ruin his August. Fill up his tank. Completely descend on him with 1,000 requests. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you, you.
I also want to give you the Birch Gold update. If you're buying gold this weekend, gold did very well yesterday. Went up to $1,923, up $7.80 an ounce. While the Dow, the S&P, and the NASDAQ all fell between 0.8 and 1.2%. It was a very bad day on the market because interest rates are going to keep going up. But gold went up to 1,923. So if you're going to buy gold, do it from hughgold.com or text my name, Hugh, to 989898. That's H-U-G-H to 989898. When you visit hughgold.com, you're in the hands of professionals who establish for you a 401k, an IRA, or a SEP IRA, or roll an old one over and put it into physical precious metals and act as your third-party intermediary depository, which is what you need. Safety, security, and legitimacy in the eyes of the IRS. That's HughGold.com, HughGold.com. And do not forget your relieffactor.com, America. There it is. I'm going to go. I did three yesterday, six the day before. Icarin, curcumin, resveratrol, and omega. By three and six, I mean miles, not packages of Relief Factor. I just took that with my lukewarm coffee because it's very easy to swallow those four pills. And those four pills make you bounce back quickly, recover more quickly if you're an athlete. Whether you're swimming or running or jumping. Yesterday, Sutchin said he had played full court basketball the day before. I felt like we should make him into a relieffactor.com commercial. Former governor of Arkansas is running for president, is still, you know, quite the great athlete at the age of 72. Whatever age you are, no matter how much you're working out, if you got minor aches and pains, relieffactor.com is for you. I'm in the relieffactor.com studio, and that's because it works, and they support me, and I support them, and I love the product, and you ought to give it a try. If you're waking up this morning, you're driving to work, and something hurts, go get your relieffactor.com. Coming right back with Ben Domenech. Going to talk with him about AI as well when we return to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Welcome back, America. Hour two of the Hugh Hewitt Show. Straight ahead, Ben Domenech, Fox News contributor. Sarah Bedford of the Washington Examiner. Join me to talk about everything that happened in an unusual week because the 4th fell on a Tuesday. So a broken up week with some big stories, including the white stuff in the West Wing. Stay tuned.
Miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
Morning Glory America. Bonjour. Hi, candidate. 7723. I'm in studio. North Bend Domenech, I believe, is melting in Virginia. Good morning, Ben. How are you?
I'm doing great. And yes, I will be as soon as I go outside this morning. Hugh, good to be with you.
Thank you. Ben, I'm going to hit you from left field with a question. Did you watch The Social Dilemma when it streamed on whatever streaming platform it was on?
You know what? I honestly skipped it on the advice of a friend, but do I need to go back and take another look at it?
No, the authors or the creators of it, Tristan Harris and Asa Raskin, have created a new presentation called The AI Dilemma, which they gave at the Aspen Ideas Festival in March. Now, when I say Aspen Ideas Festival, what does Ben Domenech think?
Ben Domenech thinks that I've actually spoken at the Aspen Ideas Festival many times, and I was by far the most right-wing person there, and that put me in a very interesting position.
do you think it is a left-wing group?
It is the definition of left neoliberal. Let me put it this way: I made a comment from the stage referencing a Netflix series produced by Michael Eisner's company. And of course I turn and I see that Michael Eisner is sitting 10 frames up in the same room at the same time that I'm dissing his show for being pro-abortion. So that was a fun little moment.
Yeah, Ben, I think people need to know that the Aspen Institute lost its way a long time ago. And I've only been there once, and it was for the Defense Forum. And therefore, and it's the last time I'm going because it went so left-wing. But they had a very fascinating presentation that John Ellis, whom I respect a lot. Do you know John?
I know his work, certainly.
Okay. So he recommended everyone watch this this presentation on artificial intelligence called The AI Dilemma by Tristan Harrison as Asa Raskin. And I did. And it's got some really bad history and some really good alarm sounding. When I say artificial intelligence to you, what does Ben Domenech think?
Well, I think that there's a couple of different attitudes that I have toward that. First, I would say that, you know, it seems to me like on the surface level, AI presents a number of problems for the creative industry. That those aspects are the ones that I'm most familiar with. You know, particularly, I play around a lot with some of the different aspects of AI when it comes to graphic arts and creative work, that type of thing. But what I'm much more concerned about is how far behind we could be when it comes to using AI. And on the security front, and particularly in the defense industry, in ways that I think, you know, are really very concerning, falling behind China, not keeping up with what we ought to be doing in an organized fashion. And then, of course, there's the human and ethical side of it, which I think opens up a whole other can of worms that would be a longer conversation than what we would have this morning.
And that's why I would want everyone to watch The AI Dilemma, because the exponential rate of growth of its ability is actually kind of stunning. I learned from this presentation. And by the way, their Center for Center for Humane Technology was initially funded by George Soros and Pierre, the other lefty. And, you know, it's just lefty. And it's Silicon Valley from the start. And they got a BS from the University of Chicago and a BS from Stanford. And that's it. And the history that they present in the AI Dilemma is just flat wrong. But their grasp of the technology is very good. And what they said, 2024 might be the last time we have a fair election because of deep fraud, deep fakes. And they made the point, they demonstrated, you need 3 seconds of someone's voice to create a speech in their voice. Did you know that, Ben?
Yeah, and in fact, it's really quite uncanny when you see what they're capable of doing when you hear it. You know, you can imagine things like that. I mean, think about the level of viral content that we have out there already that is inaccurate and that can spread very quickly and that is impossible to really chase and track down. And the response from the left, of course, on this front is to say we need to empower government to be able to come in and put a heavy foot down when it comes to anything that we think could be problematic. And that, I think, is, you know, something that we should be very concerned about. You know, if we believe in limited government and if we believe in free speech, you know, at the same time, that doesn't mean that we should turn a blind eye to the fact that the ability to create out of nowhere non-existent things that are being said or sound like they're being said by famous politicians and the like, you know, can be extremely damaging, not just to the national psyche, but, you know, just think about what this could do to markets, to the economy, when it comes to creating instability, and, you know, the weaponization of that, not just politically, but by America's enemies, I think could be very powerful.
Think as well, Ben, about when and if the exponential growth they talk about occur. And by the way, I am persuaded that it's the technology is rapidly advancing, more rapidly than the ability of mankind to move at speed. So what took us 100 years from the airplane to hypersonics is going to take 1 year in AI, and that AI is now getting to the point where it can teach itself. ChatGPT 5.0 will teach itself more ChatGPT, and China, of course, is in this. Other technologists are into this, and I hope DARPA is into this. But you're exactly right. When you get to the end of the AI dilemma, which is very good, very persuasive, they recommend leaders from the civic society movement and government get involved, and they talk about a Biden White House summit. And I thought to myself, my God, they're progressives. They really don't understand freedom. And when people start talking about experts taking over, what does Ben Domenech think?
I think that the class of experts that we have currently and that we've had now for the last two decades or more has really done a terrible job in virtually every aspect of American life, whether that's managing the conflicts that we've had overseas, to dealing with the challenges of our economy, to dealing with a social breakdown. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, you saw all those stats probably, Hugh, that this July 4th, there was such high levels of institutional distrust in virtually every aspect of, you know, the institutions that are so important to American life. And of course, coming out of this pandemic, that even furthered it, demolishing faith in public health institutions that, you know, previously had essentially been uncontroversial outside of a few areas. And that's the kind of thing that I think is really concerning, because getting back to a point where we can have faith in those institutions is a very difficult and long path. And the shortcut for these institutions is to instead invest themselves with enormous power in order to force you to do the thing that they want you to do, that you are no longer willing to do because you have levels of distrust that you didn't have before.
And the Chinese Communist Party is running such a society now about AI, and they are collecting data on us all. But what I want to people to understand is Silicon Valley is not to be trusted either, because Silicon Valley is genuinely ignorant of American history. And I don't mean stupid. I just mean they got it wrong. In this presentation, they talk about the movie The Day After, which you're too young to remember. They invent an impact of it on Ronald Reagan. They suggest that the Reykjavik summit was a success and launched nuclear disarmament. I mean, they're really wrong when they're wrong. But that doesn't mean they're wrong about technology. It means that you don't trust their solutions. They're very good at spotting the problem, but I don't know where we would begin to develop a solution except that maybe DARPA.
Well, you should always be skeptical when you're having a conversation with someone from Silicon Valley, and their primary critique of the movie Minority Report is that it just really needed better and more reliable AI than three people laying in a pond. You know, that's the kind of attitude you get from some of these folks. Oh, I can just fix it. You know, I can fix this problem. And it's like, no, this is not a problem to be fixed. That's not, you're approaching this the whole wrong way. And yet I think that unfortunately we're so far behind the eight ball when it comes to political leadership on these issues. I know that AI is a top concern for Mike Gallagher, who's obviously a guest regularly on your show. And I also know a handful of other members and leaders who are concerned about it. But for the most part, this is something where they are not paying attention to the issues. And so they're going to be ill-prepared, I think, when it comes to having a response to the natural power-hungry attitudes of the left in investing more power in the government to strike down something that they view as a problematic. It is a problem, but there are better ways, I think, to address it than simply giving more power to a government that's going to simply, I think, not be trusted and people will rebel against.
On the spot, it's tough to come up with an answer, Cole, but where would you begin to develop a regulatory structure? Because I don't think we have one for AI right now. Where would you begin?
Well, I think that that's something that would take a much longer conversation. But one of the things that I think is key is that we need to be very careful about the way that we approach the use of AI when it comes to the defense side of things in ways that are designed to help enable humans to make better decisions as opposed to allowing things to work without that level of human involvement. the point where you remove the human, essentially, or you allow the AI to remove the human, is the point where things, both theoretically and in some cases in testing circumstances, really go off the rails. And so it's important to understand that the human is key when it comes to anything that we're doing on the defense application side. We can't just automate everything. And even though
I do think we're going to have to go to mutual assured destruction with the CCP right away on AI. Ben Domenech, B. Domenech on Twitter, Fox News contributor, editor at large for The Spectator. Have a great weekend, Ben. I'll be right back. America, stay tuned.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by the Council for Citizens Against Government Waste.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, 7/7/23. I hope you have, and for many of you, I know this has been like a 10-day week. You took off last Friday. You're taking off this Friday. The 4th of July was on, and you're just taking everything off. That's fine. Glad you're here. Thank you for joining us. I am going down to Orlando at the end of the month to be with ALEC, the American Legislative Exchange Council, ALEC.org. And I always talk to them about rich states, poor states, which is over at ALEC.org, A-L-E-C.org, for the benefit of the Steelers fans out there, A-L-E-C.org. They are a sponsor of the program, and their new Rich States, Poor States is out. I'm going to ask them mostly about school choice, about gambling on sports, about NIL, and other legislative regimes that are state-specific. And I'm going to ask them about artificial intelligence, because the federal government isn't going to get up to doing anything anytime soon. They're not organized for it. They're not experts. There's no agency for it. And I'm not sure I want them to, but each of the states might want to adopt a different policy on artificial intelligence and its use by the government, by the state government. And they may want to prohibit it and make it a federal government standard only and sort of preempt out. But I'm going to talk with the people about that at ALEC, American Legislative Exchange Council. Go over to ALEC.org and learn more. And I look forward to that presentation, that broadcast every single year in July. And it's in Orlando, so Dwayne will come in for about an hour, then he'll be over to Disney World because he's woke Dwayne. By the way, speaking of woke, last night I was reading an essay by Joseph Epstein about Thomas Wolfe, the late great new journalist and novelist, and what he did to radical chic needs to be done to woke, because they are the same thing. Radical chic and woke are the same thing, but we don't have a Tom Wolfe anymore to kind of go to the Aspen Ideas Festival where the AI documentary presentation was aired, the AI dilemma, A.I. dilemma. You can watch it on YouTube. We need someone to go there and do the Tom Wolfe thing. And we need it soon. I hope you caught yesterday my other sponsor, Tom Schatz, on the program talking about these Council for Citizens Against Government Waste and talking about Senate Bill 1339 by Bernie Sanders. They are a sponsor of the show because they are collecting you to write to your legislators at the Senate, especially to stop Bernie Sanders' Senate Bill 1339. That will destroy the price of drugs. Now, I got to go get a medication today that is not covered by my insurance. It isn't. It's a acid reflux deal. And it's a new one. It worked perfectly, but you know they don't do new things in a hurry. And my pharmacy benefit manager doesn't cover it. Maybe I'll change to one in open season. But I don't want Bernie to tell me what acid reflux I need. Bernie would probably prohibit coffee because that's the principal reason I have acid reflux. But I know that Senate Bill 1339 is a bad idea. So please go to the website that they have put together over at lowermydrugprices.com. Lowermydrugprices.com. It will generate communications by you for your senators and your congressperson telling them, stop. I wish I had that. Is it the Supreme? Stop in the name of love. Stop in the name of lower drug prices. So go to lowermydrugprices.com today. Participate in stopping Bernie yet again. All right. Lowermydrugprices.com. Finally, relieffactor.com studios. I have got here my other Relief Factor package. I have got it for tomorrow. I'm going to take it back home from the studio, Studio North, to make sure that I am able to take it and enjoy it. You know, I've got a new gang of people that I run around with here, and it's Josh the Marine and Tony the CRE guy, and Mark the Digger and Brian the Banker, and these are guys I hang out with, and they do funny stuff, right? They're out on the water in boats, and they go clamming and lobstering and fishing and things I don't do. But I gotta bring a sack load of Relief Factor because these guys are all my age, roughly, give or take a few years, and they need relieffactor.com. But everybody who exercises does, all right? Relieffactor.com. I'm in the relieffactor.com studio for a reason. They support this show, and I support their product because it works. I take it every single day. And so if you see me out trundling along the highways and the byways of the Beltway, along Huntington Beach or way up north, that's because relieffactor.com has kept me in the game. And the only way for you to stay in the game with ReliefFactor.com is to go get their initial trial pack, $19.95. ReliefFactor.com, ReliefFactor.com. $19.95. And from the ReliefFactor.com, beautiful studios, I'm here to tell you, it works, it works, it works. I do want to play for you Kamala Harris yesterday. It's the one bit of audio I can't miss. Cut number two, please. Cut number two.
Well, I think culture is, it is a reflection of our moment and our time, right? And present culture is the way we express how we're feeling about the moment. And we should always find times to express how we feel about the moment that is a reflection of joy, because, you know, it comes in the morning. We have to find ways to also express the way we feel about the moment in terms of just having language and a connection to how people are experiencing life. And I think about it in that way, too. Well,
I have no idea what she's saying. None. But no one did in the audience, but they all nodded. My phone number is 1-800-520-1234. I've been talking about the AI dilemma all morning. I'm going to do one more segment on it. All right. So I want to hear from you what you think about the AI dilemma. 1-800-520-1234. Connection to me, Hugh Hewitt. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. I hope you're going to have a great weekend. I hope in the course of that weekend you find the time, 70 minutes. It takes 70 minutes from start to finish to watch the AI Dilemma. Now, the AI Dilemma is a presentation. I've been talking about it all morning, and I would like to know if you have any comments on what you've heard. 1-800-520-1234. I think you ought to watch it. I think you ought to watch it with your guard up, because the youngsters, they are 39 and 40, so I consider them youngsters, are Silicon Valley people. And they got a not-for-profit, and they've got a Stanford and a University of Chicago BS, and they're computer science geeks. They do not know history. That is self-evident from this clip of their presentation from the Aspen Ideas Summit. Cut number 12, Tristan Harris, Asa Raskin at the Ideas Summit. Cut number 12.
Could you imagine how different we would be walking into this next age? We walked into the nuclear age, but at least we woke up and we created the UN Bretton Woods. We're walking into the AI age, but we're not waking up and creating institutions that span countries. Imagine how different it would be if there was a nationalized, televised, not debate, but discussion from the heads of the major labs and companies and the lead safety experts like the Eliezers. And civic actors. And we really gave this moment in history the weight that it deserves versus another sort of weird article in the New York Times about how the chatbot tried to break up the reporter from their wife.
Yeah. Part of why we did this is that we noticed that the media has not been covering this in a way that lets you see kind of the picture of the arms race. It's actually been one of our focuses is getting and helping media who help the world understand these issues, not see them as chatbots or see it as just AI art, but seeing it as there's a systemic challenge where we're racing, that corporations are currently caught, not because they want to be, because they're caught in this arms race to deploy it and to get market dominance as fast as possible. And none of them can stop it on their own. It has to be some kind of negotiated agreement where we all collectively say, which future do we want? Just like nuclear de-escalation. And what we have heard when we asked all the top AI safety people that we know, and we've been on just like dozens and dozens and dozens of phone calls, and what we hear from everybody that would help the most is to selectively slow down the public deployment of these large language model AIs. This is not about stopping the research. This is not about not building AI. It's about slowing down the public deployment. And just like we do with drugs or with airplanes, where you do not just build an airplane and then just not test it before you onboard people onto it, or you build drugs that have interaction effects with society that the people who made the drug couldn't have predicted, we can presume that systems that have capacities that the engineers don't even know what those capacities will be, we can presume that they're not necessarily safe until proven otherwise. We don't just shove them into products like Snapchat. And we can put the onus on the makers of AI rather than on the citizens to prove why they think that it's dangerous. And I know that some people might be saying, but hold on a second. If we slow down public deployment of AIs, aren't we just going to lose to China? And honestly, you know, we want to be very clear. All of our concerns, especially on social media as well, we want to make sure we don't lose to China. We would actually argue that the public deployment of AIs, just like social media, that were unregulated, that incohered our society, are the things that make us lose to China. Because if you have an incoherent culture, your democracy doesn't work. It's exactly the sort of unregulated or reckless deployment that causes us to lose to China. Now, when we asked our friends, you know, how would you think about this question, they said, well, actually, right now, the Chinese government considers these large language models actually unsafe because they can't control them. They don't ship them publicly to their own population. Yeah.
They quite literally do not trust they can't get their golems to not talk about Tiananmen Square. In the same way that Snapchat is unable to get their ChatGPT, their golem, to not be persuaded into grooming a child.
And that slowing down the public release of AI capabilities would actually slow down Chinese advances too. Now, Aza, I think you should explain this because why would it be the case that slowing down public releases would slow down Chinese?
So what we've heard from, as we've interviewed many of the AI researchers, that China is often fast following what the US has done. And so it's actually the open source models that help. Could you imagine how different we would be?
All right, so they're wrong about that. They're not fast following. They are stealing everything that we make. And so unless it's done by DARPA, consider it stolen by the CCP's vast network of intelligence operatives in the United States, either on visas or deeply embedded within big tech or via a licensing agreements if you want to operate in China. Microsoft has given them whatever they've got. Just understand that. That's just what they do. So there's a lot of naivete. There's also a lot of bad history. Do you hear them mention the UN and Bretton Woods? The UN and Bretton Woods have nothing to do with nuclear nonproliferation. The regime that we did have failed. Atoms for Peace failed. Every effort to police Pakistan, India, Israel, Iran, nuclearization has thus far failed. Proliferation seems to me to be inevitable. But on the other hand, these two guys really know. I mean, they've had dozens and dozens of conversations. All right, that's like my week. I've had two conversations this morning with Sonny Bunch and Ben Domenech about AI. So I could say, I had some conversations last week, and I've written about it. And so, I can start the Center for Hugh on AI. Please send me $1 million, and I'll talk a lot more about AI. I don't know what these guys know, and I don't know what they value, all right? Until you tell me what you value, I don't know how to interpret your moral choices. Do you believe in a soul? Why are you even concerned about the extinction of human? Why? I mean, is it because your genetic code wants to replicate, as Richard Dawkins says in The Selfish Gene? Or is it because you believe in the Baltimore Catechism, the fundamental purpose of man is to know, love, and serve God? Are you someone who has faith? Because if you don't have faith, I'm not sure I want to hear your solutions for humanity. I don't know what your faith has to be. It could be a general deist faith of the very thin veneer sort that Thomas Jefferson had, or the deeply religious sort that James Madison had, or the evolutionary sort that Ben Franklin had, or the Mason-influenced understanding of Christianity that George Washington had. And there are a lot of great scholars who think George Washington was a deeply evangelical person, or whether it's Charles Carroll, the only Catholic signer of the Declaration of Independence, his understanding of faith. I need to know, before I trust your judgment about what to do about a new technology, who you are. All right, so I don't know anything about these two people except that their startup funding came from hard left folks like George Soros and Pierre, whatever, Odemeyer, whatever his name is. The two biggies who started The Intercept and generally have no idea what they're doing with their money. I need to talk to Peter Thiel about this. But I want to know what you think about this. Will you now watch The AI Dilemma? Joey in Seattle. Good morning, Joey. How are you?
Good morning, Hugh. The only reason I'm up is to listen to you. I often do that in the middle of the night.
Well, thank you.
I wish you were on at a different hour. My question is, I am a technologically challenged person. What can I do in the face of this? What can an ordinary person do in the face of this? Because I didn't realize it was such a big deal and that it could be so dangerous in the wrong hands, and that we may lose control of it. I had no idea.
We've already lost control of it. What you can do, I would suggest, is start by watching on YouTube. It's free, The AI Dilemma, but doing so with the knowledge that the people who are talking about how to regulate it don't know what they're talking about. They know about the technology. They don't know what to do. And what they think we ought to do is based upon a deeply flawed understanding of history. I had a note from my friend Captain Hendricks, who is studying the beginning of the nuclear age and Andrew Marshall's work at the Pentagon and how George Marshall and everybody else marshaled technology to advance in World War II on an epic scale. And people like historians will tell you what works and doesn't work. Military historians of the sort that Dr. Hendricks are will tell you what happens in an arms race. So I would watch The AI Dilemma, but I would not accept their solutions. Does that make sense, Joey?
Yes, it makes great sense. Thank you.
All right. Start there. I want to remind all of you out there that I'm not sure why you gave me a three-minute warning, Adam. Have I failed to? Oh, myphdweightloss.com. That's why. Adam speaks in my ear. Dwayne has gone off to Tennessee. He's roasting deer in the backyard of Schroeder right now. They got a big deer barbecue in the back. Schroeder goes out in his bib overalls and his shotgun, gets himself a deer, and he puts it on a spit, and he turns it in the backyard. Then he's going to put Dwayne to work building a shed, because that's what he does on his – he's going to have – like it's shed land out in the boonies of Knoxville. So Dwayne has gone to Knoxville. So all of you volunteer state people, you're not safe. But you're not going to recognize him either, because he's skinny Dwayne. And skinny Dwayne lost 50 pounds using all of this, myphdweightloss.com, which is common sense and smart. And I encourage you to call 864-644-1900. 864-644-1900, because Dwayne is the living proof that if you need to lose 50 pounds, that's the way to go. I'm not a big fan of drugs for weight loss, not at all. But I think you ought to go get myphdweightloss.com. Wesley in St. Simons Island, Georgia. Hi, Wesley. What do you think about the AI dilemma?
Well, the most important, the most intelligent thing I've ever heard, the wisest thing I've ever heard you say on the radio was for us to determine the world and life view that these people have that we're listening to, and whether or not they know the Lord, or whether they're, you know, some kind of humanist or Gnostic or whatever. Because you're exactly correct, Hugh, and I want to thank you so much for saying that, because this country was built on pragmatic people who knew God and knew what worked in reality and knew how to move forward using biblical principles. And these guys obviously don't. And I just appreciate so much you raising that red flag for us as we watch this very important video.
Now, the interesting thing about it, they call it the Center for Humane Technology, which is a red flag for me. It's a red flag for me when someone says humane, because humanists are not going to know the answer here, right? They're just not,
right.
Wesley.
Right. Thank you.
Hey, thank
You're
you.
Right.
A guy named Wesley is maybe named for John Wesley or his brother. That's a great call. Thank you, friend. Coming right back with Sarah Bedford on The Week That Was. What about the white stuff in the West Wing? Sarah will tell us next on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of The Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by PhD Weight Loss and Nutrition. Go to myphdweightloss.com to learn more.
Welcome back, America. Sarah Bedford is the Washington Examiner reporter who covers Congress. Good morning, Sarah. How are you?
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
Sarah, who put the white stuff in the West Wing? What do we know?
That is an excellent question. One thing that I think we do know is that there's no way the Secret Service is unable to figure out the culprit. I mean, maybe they're unwilling, but this is an area of the West Wing that can only be accessed if you've gone through what they call the WAVE system. So you have to provide your social security number. You have to give them at least 24 hours in advance so they can conduct a quick background check, or you're a staff member who has to beep into the area with their identification badge, and all of the entries and exits to the West Wing would be time-stamped from the Secret Service, who's processing people in and out. And then obviously there's cameras all over it. It's the West Wing. So the idea that the Secret Service is not going to be able to narrow down who passed through this area in this one day is really baffling, why they're putting it out there before they've even conducted the investigation, that it's not going to lead anywhere.
I want to tell anyone who's ever been in the West Wing, or at least in recent years, as you enter the visitor's exit on Executive Avenue, West Executive Avenue, there is what looks like an old card catalog. And it's a little wooden locker system, and you have to put your electronics in that. They do not allow you to put. At first, I thought they were saying that the coke was found in that. Then Nora O'Donnell reported on Andrea Mitchell's show yesterday the following. Let's listen to this, Sarah, cut number one.
Kelly, the big change is where this was found. And it was found, by my observation, in a much more secure place, limited access place, than that West Wing reception area. It's still a publicly frequently trafficked place, but it's down near the Situation Room, right off West Executive, down below. And normal people, just average people, just can't get in there, even with the entry from the Northwest Gate.
Well, let me bring you up to date with the reporting that I have. What we have learned is that there are, in fact, two West Wing entrances. You know that, I know that, but for the benefit of our audience. And now the investigation has progressed, and so they're saying the West Executive entrance, which, as you noted, is closer to the Situation Room and closer to the Navy mess, where there's the facilities for food and so forth. It is also next to West Executive Drive. That's where, for example, the vice president's vehicle is parked.
Okay. I think it's in the cubbies. And I don't presume you don't know this. There's a front door and there's a side door. And the side door, you don't get into the West Wing, right, Sarah? You just don't get in unless you've been pre-cleared. And if you've got electronics, you put it in the cubby.
Right. I mean, I think that even if it had been found in the original location that we were all led to believe, which was the cubbies, I think to say before the investigation was even conducted that it's not going to lead anywhere, to sort of preclude ever finding the culprit, even when it was there, was dubious. And now that we know that it could have been in an even more secure and exclusive part of the West Wing, this idea that they're not going to catch who it is and they're uninterested in catching who it is, really, I think, should make the public even more curious.
Oh, it's appalling.
Brought it in.
One thing, we shouldn't be guessing. There are maps of the West Wing. Everybody knows. Everyone who's been in there, like millions of people go to the mess. I mean, people go to, I went to the mess in 1985 like 20 times because people wanted to go to the mess. The mess is open to many, many people, but we know everyone who goes into it, right? Because you don't want anyone bringing in the kind of stuff that can be malware or explosive. And they're all certain. We know everything about everyone who walks in there.
Right. For situations exactly like this, for the purposes of, like you said, preventing people from bringing in dangerous things or things like drugs, all that information is on hand in the event that someone does something wrong. And this is exactly why the Secret Service exists at the White House, is to protect the president from, you know, harmful things and harmful people. And they're set up to solve mysteries like who brought drugs into an exclusive area of the White House. So I think the pressure should stay on. I mean, it's surprising that we've seen sort of corporate media ask any questions at all. But that pressure should stay on for the Secret
Service. Credit where credit is due. Andrea Mitchell's getting hammered by left-wingers because she's brought this up. But it is quite, any Washington, D.C. veteran of any standing knows exactly what the Secret Service knows. They know where they found it. They could show us a map, and they could narrow it down very quickly, right?
Right. And I think that's sort of that's the key point, is that it should be easy for them to figure it out. But so quickly they came out and said that we're not going to find anything. Before we even started investigating, let's just set expectations that we're not going to come out of this with a culprit. And that in itself is really questionable, because they could very easily find out who had this substance.
Sarah C. Bedford on Twitter. Have you joined Threads yet, Sarah C. Bedford?
I refuse. I barely participate in social media as it is, so I won't.
All right. Well, I joined it because, you know, I'm on Instagram. Not really, but I did just post a little bit about the show, and I encourage everyone, if you're going to go Threads, follow me there. But I prefer Twitter, and I don't think they'll ever overthrow Twitter because there are too many of us on Twitter. Thank you, Sarah C. Bedford, and don't go anywhere, America. I'll be right back with Matt Spalding, Dean of the Kirby Center, the Graduate School of of Hillsdale College, in the Hillsdale Dialogue. The last radio hour of the week is next, live here on From Studio North, The Hugh Hewitt Show.
The Hugh Hewitt Show is now available on TV. Go to salemnewschannel.com or download the app. You can also watch on Roku and Fire Stick. Salem News Channel, the antidote to the mainstream media.